Wacom had two events in June of this year. One was called the 39th Ordinary Shareholders Meeting, and the 39 is because this is the 39th fiscal year for Wacom. And they followed up that event with a briefing to demonstrate technology. I know many of you are just wondering, did they announce any new products? Well, the answer is they did not announce any new products. I watched both events and I'm going to highlight key parts of both events. This is Wacom's CEO, Nobu Ide. Now, he ran both sessions and I have to say, he seems like a really cool guy. You can tell he has a lot of passion for the company, the technology, and the customers. Let's quickly get the boring financial stuff out of the way. Ending their 39th fiscal year, their net profit was about $76 million US. In fact, this was their record high net profit. It seems like they're doing okay as a business. Wacom splits apart their work into two primary business units. One is called the branded business. The other is called the technology solutions business. The branded business is all about the products that they sell that are branded Wacom. This means the name Wacom is going to appear on the box. The technology solutions business means they license their technologies to other manufacturers for their products. So on the boxes of their products, you won't see the word Wacom. It'll be the other company. Ignore this chart. What's important is on the bottom. It says chapter 2 and chapter 3. Wacom organizes their strategic efforts into what they call chapters that span multiple fiscal years. Wacom is currently in their chapter 3 phase. The theme of chapter 3 is lifelong Inc. The summary of this concept is that Wacom thinks about their pen technologies and the experiences from those technologies as being involved with someone throughout their life. In the technology briefing session, Nobu talked to several teams inside Wacom. So for the remainder of this video, I will highlight those conversations and I will make a commentary on the demonstrations. And just to be clear, I am not covering everything that they talked about. I'm just focused on the things that I think the audience of this channel would be interested in, which is of course primarily things about drawing. The first team Nobu talked to is the EMR team, EMR, electromagnetic resonance. It is the core technology that powers all drawing tablets today. If you're curious how it works, I made a video about EMR and the fundamentals a few months ago. The link to that video is in the video description below. Nobu was talking to one of the EMR engineers, and what she is saying, it's about the pen display that she's next to. She's saying how the engineers have to deal with all the electrical interference caused by the display panel and by the other peripheral components inside the device. If they do not handle this interference, the end result is you will not be able to draw a nice smooth line. So the engineers are always looking at the interference, measuring it, and trying to figure out how to compensate for it in the firmware. They didn't announce anything new about EMR. I wanted to include this because Nobu made a special request. He wanted to make it clear that whenever you draw a nice smooth line with one of their tablets, you should think and picture about her face, because it's through the tremendous efforts of her and her team that you're able to have such a nice drawing experience. Please keep her in mind and give her and her team a huge round of applause. Next, Nobu moved on to the AES team. Just like EMR, AES is another pen technology that Wacom developed. It stands for active electrostatic. EMR and AES are both digital pen technologies, but they work very differently. Drawing tablets all use EMR. Other kinds of pen-based tablets like Microsoft Surface Pro or an iPad, they use AES or something very similar to how AES works. There are two things they talked about with AES. Number one, Nobu talked to this engineer who showed how their pen designs evolve over time from a very basic prototype to the final product. At the beginning, it's this empty cardboard box, and they've taped to that box a pen and this circuit board, and it looks, you know, very cumbersome and weird and very rough. And you can see how every progressive step makes it smaller and smaller until finally they're left with this final little slim circuit board. And that's what they put in the pen casing for the final product. I thought this was really intriguing to see this because I have just used the pens. I've never actually seen how they're developed. So I really liked that they showed this. The second thing they talked about with AES is, well, it's funny, Nobu's kind of funny. You can see here, he's threatening to spray water on one of the engineers. Now, this is all just a joke. It was a spontaneous thing that happened. They're all laughing and having fun with it. But the water is important for the demonstration. With a typical AES device, if there's water on the surface, well, you'll have a hard time using a finger or a pen to draw on it. And you've probably seen something like this with, for example, if you have an iPad. I certainly have many times. In this demonstration, they're spraying some water on the AES surface, and you can see the water there, and the engineer is using his finger to draw on the surface, even though it's completely wet. And it seemed to track his finger perfectly. Seems like a really practical, useful development, and I hope that we see this in production soon. Then Nobu moved on to the VR team, virtual reality. Everyone's talking about metaverse these days, and Wacom is one of many companies exploring it. This engineer is demonstrating how it works. You can see he's holding up a pen tablet and the pen, and he's drawing in midair and drawing, and simultaneously he's looking through a VR headset, and he sees the pen tablet in the VR space, and the pen is there too, and he's drawing. And well, I have to admit, I don't know anything about VR for real, and I don't know how people really want to work with VR, so I'm not really sure what to make of it. But for those of you who are into VR, you may see something quite compelling here. Then Nobu talked to the DRM team. This is the team working on digital rights management. There are two things on the slide. On the left is a drawing. Doesn't matter what it really is. What is important on the right side, there's another weird thing. And what that is, it's not a drawing. It's a visualization of the pen data, all the strokes and pressure and tilt and hovering and all that went into drawing the picture. And it's a visualization of all that data. And this visualization represents this data, which represents a fingerprint. And this fingerprint, this visualization of that pen data, is something they can use for proof of authorship. In the demo, they show someone has drawn this very simple picture, and they press this button and the picture goes and is sent to the cloud, and the pen data is sent there. Then someone else downloads that from the cloud. Now what they see is exactly what the author sees. There's no visible difference whatsoever. It's exactly the same image. But that fingerprint is invisibly embedded in that picture, and that constitutes the proof of authorship. If you look at the left side, you'll see this watermark. The watermark says, this artwork has been registered to somebody, and that somebody is the creator of the artwork. The key thing there is that the creator didn't really have to do anything. They just saved it to the cloud, and the proof of authorship was automatically handled and invisibly embedded in that drawing. Then Nobu mentioned something interesting, a partnership with a company named Celsius. This name may not be familiar, but they are the company that makes the creative application called Clip Studio Paint. Clip Studio Paint is a super, super popular drawing application, and it's especially useful for people who are doing things with a lot of line work, like comics. What Nobu revealed is that there's a joint development effort between Wacom and Celsius, and they're looking at incorporating a number of these Wacom technologies that I'm talking about into Clip Studio Paint, into the user experience. Now, they didn't show anything. They didn't talk about specific features. They certainly didn't talk about a timeline. But I have to say, regardless of all that, I was very excited to see that there is this partnership, that they're working together, and that Clip Studio Paint users are going to see some experience improvements. Well, that wraps it up for this video. I hope this gave you a good sense of what Wacom is doing, how they think about what they're doing, and how deeply they care about pen technology and their customers, and how it's going to affect the future. I hope you enjoyed this video. Thank you for your time.